end of that musical prelude. We don't hear that very often anymore, the amen at the end of a piece of music. Welcome. Welcome to St. Andrews. Welcome to this beautiful, beautiful space. Welcome back to some of you who've been gone for a while. Very glad to see you, and sorry for the crutches. Welcome to those of you who came especially today because of All Saints Sunday. This is a sacred day the world over, celebrated by Christians in different ways, and we do it in our St. Andrews way. I felt that this was a service that needed to be about bomb, not B-O-M-B, B-A-L-M, bomb for us in our times, and I hope it will be that for you. I want to first make a couple of announcements about what's happening in our community these days. The first is that Russ isn't here today. He's at Windhorse Farm with the TLI, the Transformational Leadership Initiative, working with them in different ways. He'll be back next week. Next week is Remembrance Sunday. And we have a service that will be co-led by a new member of our congregation, Wendy Keene. She's a United Church minister who was a career chaplain in the military. And she and Kevin and I and Russ have worked together for an interesting service. Think about this. It is her first service in a non-military setting for Remembrance Day for decades for her. And so what do you think her message will be for us? Come next week. And see. We remind one another that whenever we gather in person here, there are others who are gathering with us online, people who are tuned in at home, people who will tune in later in the week when they have time. And so what happens in worship and in these walls does not ever, ever stay just in these walls. There is an openness that happens when we come together to worship. A couple of things that you might want to know about. The first is that we do have a book club that is reading a book a month, and many people have been reading this one, Brené Brown's Braving the Wilderness. And with every month, we have online discussions, but then we have one in-person gathering, a bit of an experiment about how to do it safely, with masks and with enough space that we can actually have conversations with one another. But we can gather, and so on Tuesday night, if you've read this book, or if you've read part of the book, come on out. We'll meet at the Mary Holmes room, and if there's too many of us, we'll spread out in the hall and just spend some time together meeting other people who read the book too. And if you come, we ask you to bring two quotations from the book, any two, that tweaked your interest. The next book that we're going to read in our series is this one, How to Be an Anti-Racist. So it will be very much a worthwhile read. If you haven't picked it up yet, you can find it in different locations, or maybe just share it and read a chapter at a time. More information about that is on our website, along with all other kinds of information. Here's a good one. The UCW, that's the United Church Women, these women who have done service for the church and the wider world in many, many ways. Every year they have a soup lunch. And we come and we buy soup, and it's really good, and we get to enjoy time together. But because of COVID, we can't do that, because you can't drink soup through a mask. So here's what they came up with. Oh, I keep looking at that screen. Here's what they came up with. It's a challenge for all of us for 1 month, a one-month challenge. And that is, every time that you eat soup, would you please put into a jar a loonie or a toonie, or several of those, every time you eat soup. It's a way to participate in this notion of the soup lunch, which was a fundraiser for the school breakfast programs. And last year they raised $780 for school breakfast, and that goes a long way. So help them out this year. Let's do it as a community in a different way. Find a jar, because otherwise you'll forget. Find a jar and put it in your kitchen. Maybe toss one loonie in to start, and then every time you have soup, put put a loonie in. Every time you think of soup, put a loonie in. And if you don't eat soup, then pick something else. Every time you have a piece of pumpkin pie, put a loonie in. And then at the end of November, we're going to bring your jars in. We're actually going to put them on the table as an offering. And we're going to give thanks for the UCW who come up with creative ways all the time to serve people. So this is All Saints Sunday. All Saints Sunday is a time when we remember intentionally again as a community those who have died, who are now saints. Ritual is part of the gift of the church. It's part of what helps ground us and get through, because grief is intense and disorienting, and sometimes things happen in your lives and in the world that change everything. And ritual is something that has been done for generations and ages to help get us through, in a way that we can help one another get through. And so today, traditionally at St. Andrew's, one of the rituals that we do is we remember those from our community who are part of this community who have died in the last year. We say their names out loud. And when we do that, we remember that in this room, countless people have gathered to say goodbye to loved ones. Countless people have brought their grief with them. And that grief is one of those things that can be very immediate and urgent, like at a funeral, or long, 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 from a death that happened years ago. And only you know how grief affects you personally. But we know together that it does. And we know that it is not restricted by time. And so together with the communion of saints, that is all those generations from before, all the way back to the biblical text, who have come together to remember and to support one another, we gather. And this year especially, when there's just so much grief out there, not only the personal grief of those who have lost, but the kind of collective grief that's happening in the world today, on the eve even of an election that's being called the world's election, not just the US election, we have a lot to hold. And so we have ritual today that will also hold that. So let's prepare ourselves for worship. Take a deep breath of this sacred room and this sacred hour. Open your hearts and trust that they will be held, even as we ask some of the harder questions of grief. And we begin with Dana Lynn and a piece of music that asks a question. This song is one that she wanted to do this morning, All Saints Sunday.
Beyond the
This candle is meant to be a light. It is meant to be a light that goes into all of the corners of darkness. In all the places that we reveal and we don't reveal, this light can go. This is the light of Christ, and it's the light of God, and it's a symbol. But it is also a sure thing. And in the days in between, the days of November, between the green and the gone, this light goes. In the wretched hollows, between the before and the now, this light goes. It is the light of Christ. It's for you, and so we pray. Holy God, for each one gathered here, we ask that this light go into their hearts and their being, that its warmth be felt in the hollows, as it has for decades, millennia, generations before, for those in need of light and warmth and hope and solace. God, leave no one out on this All Saints Day. Amen. Another way that we warm one another is that we actually share the peace, trusting that even though we can't shake hands or give a hug, we can stand up and we can look somebody in the eye and from our heart say, "The peace of Christ be with you." Let's stand up and spread it around the room. Peace. Is about the journey of life, which is what we're all about when we gather here. We are pilgrims on a journey.
Thank you.
Did you notice that it was in the chorus that said, when you laugh, I'll laugh with you, that I messed up the changing of the slide? Every Sunday, there's something that I do. This is Laura Falloon. We're going to share in this ritual of the reading of the names. That's what we're going to do now. And Laura, I'll invite you over here. There is a power in saying names out loud again, isn't there? Especially for those who have passed away. And so this reading of the names is a time for us all to remember these people and to remember those who are mourning them and to give them life again in this room. And so as we read each name, one member of the congregation, just a person from the congregation, not connected to this family, but connected to this community and therefore to all of us, is going to take a flower and place it in the vase. So we'll take time with this ritual and we'll give space to each person as we give thanks for their life. And so we begin.
Glennis Farquhar. Millicent Rice. Stuart Hattie. Jean-François Maillot. Carol McEwen. Kathy McNutt. Susan McDonald. Lorraine Spracklin.
flowers will remain on our altar throughout the service, and we hold these people and their families in our service, in our worship, and in our prayers. Amen. We have two readings for you this morning. The first one is a poem. I'm a big fan of poetry, as is Don Brown. We share this together. This one is called Bewilderment, and it is meant to be about that kind of in-between stage of the before and the after. It's by Robert Theisels. In the season between green and gone, when the circle breaks and the loose ends point downward and upward at the same time, we enter a dance of a different story. How necessary this breaking of our closed circles of certainty. It is like the opening of a spiral of never again returning to the same starting place. A spiral that can ascend to spirit and be given new eyes. A spiral that can descend to soul and find welcome. Welcome. And our second reading, Laura will share, it's from Hebrews.
This reading is from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God.
So I remember Laura, when I first came here, I think you were in like grade 4. And part of a great thing about a community is watching people grow. It's very cool. And I love hearing the voice of the little one today, because if we are talking about those who have gone on before, we were reminded by the little ones that life does continue and it goes on in different ways. Love it. All Saints Sunday is something that comes every year, right? It's one of those Sundays on the church calendar that comes every year. And for me, that's always kind of a marker, like Christmas or a birthday. It's a marker of where we are. And one of the things that I do, usually I'm the one who makes the PowerPoint. I go back to the PowerPoint from the last year and I think, well, what did we do that year? What pictures did we use? What readings did we use? What songs did we sing? And this year, I went back to last year's PowerPoint and it was like a completely different world. The nature of All Saints, year after year after year, is kind of eternal, at least in terms of the life of the church. The circumstances under which we gather changes. And this year, it just felt really different. So with All Saints, there is this very personal aspect of remembering the people in our lives, of the grief that's brought into the room. The immediate grief of people who died just this year, that is not a long time, 1 year, is not a long time. And the grief that's immediate in this room, because it's deep in our hearts, and 1 year doesn't make a difference sometimes when you are that deeply in connection with another person. And so the grief is with us still. So there's that personal aspect. And this year, there's all this other grief that's being carried in the world, and that we're kind of asked to be carried as Christians in our lives and in our worship. And so it really felt to me kind of like the weight of the world was what we were talking about this year. And Kevin and I explored that a little bit, the weight of the world in personal terms and in collective terms. You know, it's like when enormous things happen, you can't believe that it's only been a year. Isn't that true? Like the death of someone that we love, that first year of grieving or the second year, or that time before and the time after, and you're in the in-between. Has it only been a year? Has it only been a few months? It's way bigger than what shows up on the calendar. And the pandemic, has that honestly only been 6 months or seven, wherever we are? Seriously? It has been a bewildering year for some of us on a personal level and some of us on a very collective way. And the poem that I read after we placed the flowers called Bewilderment. It spoke of the season between green and gone. November, All Saints. Grief, the week before an election, when the circle of certainty breaks and the loose ends point downward and upward at the same time. And it's a circle that's broken, this circle of certainty, right? We're here. We know that we're here. We know what we're doing. We know how life is going. But that circle gets broken and it becomes more like a spiral. And all we know for sure is that we're not going back to exactly the same starting point where we were before. I read that poem to Kevin. So we were talking about the weight of the world and All Saints when we were discussing this service. And when I read the poem, he looked at me for a minute like my students used to look at me in grade 10 when we would do the poetry unit. And I read it and then he said, well, what does that mean? Because that's what poetry does. And then of course, after a few minutes of thinking about it, he was like, oh yeah, I get it. But it did make me realize that poetry is not actually the best starting point for a sermon, necessarily. So you'll be glad to know that I think that maybe we should go back. The truth is that one rarely knows where to look for meaning. And by necessity, the only place that you can start to look for meaning, not necessarily in a poem, not necessarily in scripture, not necessarily even in a song, although those things really do help. The truth is, the only place we can start is where we are. And that's our lives. The only place that you are going to start finding meaning for these big, big questions like where do we go from here? Is in your life, your day-to-day life. What are we doing every day? We try to help where we can, right? We try to survive our own trials and stresses. We try to survive our illnesses. We try to survive elections. We try to survive what's being asked of us every day. We work really hard at not being driven crazy by noise, or speed, or extremely annoying people whose names we are too polite to say out loud. We try not to be tipped up or tripped up by major global sadness or the bigger questions of the world and what's going to happen. And we really try not to be tripped up by difficulties in our families or the death of old pets. We work hard. We enjoy life as we can. We try to help ourselves and we try to help one another. We try to be more present and a little less petty. Some days go better than others. And we look for solace. We look for solace in nature and music and exercise, and maybe, if we're lucky, in the quiet satisfaction of our homes. But then there's something big, and the circle turns to a spiral. There's a mass shooting. Doesn't that seem like a long time ago? Not to the people who are living it still. There's a pandemic. There's a phone call. There's a diagnosis. There's a last breath. There's a stillness. Joan Didion wrote that grief, when it comes, is nothing like we expect it to be. And in truth, oftentimes grief doesn't actually come. Not like that word implies. Sometimes it does. Sometimes there is a moment when grief comes and it hits. But more often than not, grief doesn't actually come with that sort of single-mindedness and unity of action that that implies, grief coming. It rather creeps up. I spent time last week with a family at a bedside holding vigil with a loved one dying of Alzheimer's, a long journey through Alzheimer's, a long kind of grief that crept up over time. And then at the vigil is even more than it has been for the last 10 years. I spent time with a family this week saying goodbye to their beloved mother and wife, a wife after a marriage of 70 plus years, if you can imagine that. And at that point, in that beautiful long life, in the time of decline toward the end, there is this sense of maybe we have one more year together. Maybe we have 3 months together. But sooner or later, one of us is going to be left without the other. Grief doesn't always come in one moment. Grief sneaks up on us. It creeps in. It takes its time. It's almost like baby steps coming up behind you. And then there is a point where it's like a giant stomping down. And here we are. Grief does not always come as we expect it. It's not what we think it will be. And I'll tell you, grief, those of us who've been through it, it doesn't just break the circle of certainty. It unseats the dominance of the self, of the ego. It unseats it. Whether it comes all at once or creeps along, it kind of takes away the dominance of our ego. The idea that we've got this, that we can fix this, that we can survive anything. The pandemic has been more like a wearing away and a kind of creeping in grief. I am having students show up at my office door. I'm having university students who've never come to this church before but see it on the corner. And they come to the door and they are struggling. They're incredibly homesick and they're grieving a thing that isn't a death, but is a kind of a death. And in some ways it's the death of their lifestyle. In some ways they're missing their support of their family. But I actually think it's a kind of death of innocence. This sense that they could do anything and nothing's gonna get in the way and they're gonna survive everything. And I think that's what it is. And I think it's a kind of grief that's just creeping up as this goes on. When it comes, grief is not what we expect it to be. How have you heard grief described? I won't go poetic, but what are some of the words? Heard it described as a wave that comes over you in times, a wave of despair, a wave of anguish, a wave of sorrow that just comes and washes over you. I've heard it described as emptiness, numbness. I've heard it described as a weight, the weight of the world where just getting stuff done or being enthusiastic around someone else isn't possible. It's like a bridge too far. Dishes in the sink can be a bridge too far when you're grieving or in the weight of the world. And then when we think about what that all means in terms of how we're feeling, we come to church on a Sunday morning and we're asked to take on the weight of the rest of the world. We come to church on Sunday morning and we're asked to think about Black lives and those suffering greatly from racism, those who've been killed, those who feel threatened, those who have lost their sense of life because of racism. We're asked to take that on. And we're asked to take on Indigenous rights, and we're asked to take on the caring of one another in community. And so the weight of the world becomes an even heavier weight. And I think that we need to pay attention as a community on the day when we recognize the communion of saints, that it is a lot. It is a lot for us to manage our own grief and manage the grief of the community and one another and carry the weight of the grief of the world all at the same time. And the truth is, we can't. We can't. Not without help. And we're not going to get help unless we ask for it. Today, I want to make a case for asking for help. There are two things that get in the way of us asking for help. I'm sure you can name the first one. It's already on your mind, I would imagine. We take pride in being strong and self-sufficient and not dependent. We take pride in being stoics. And we uphold stoicism. Be strong, carry on, get over it and move on. And we all know that we're not supposed to be saying those things, but who do we say them to the most? Ourselves. And it gets in the way of asking for help because it makes us seem like we're weak. Like we can't actually cope. And whether it's the kind of sneaking up on you grief or the crashing wave of grief, it's not actually something that we can bear on our own. This is the wisdom of the ages. Ask anyone who has been through grief. Read the poetry about it. Listen to the songs about it. Read the scripture about it. Or ask your neighbor sitting here today, did you get through grief on your own? One of the most profound and transformative lessons of going through grief is this: we are all interconnected. That's the pain of it, right? You are so connected to another that when they die, you are at the core of your being in pain. And that's also the gift of it. We are all connected. And so there is this potential for pain, but there is this potential for solace and for hope. We are all connected at the core of our being. And so you can feel the love of another, and you can look at the revitalization of nature and feel some sort of connection and hope. The interconnectedness, that great lesson of grief that is a potential for pain, is also the potential for solace and for hope. And the weight of the world that you carry is the weight of the world that carries you. Think about this. Christian, Muslim, Buddhist, all the great faiths talk about this in some form or another, the interconnectedness of life. This is truth. We carry the weight of the world, but the weight of the world carries us. And our lives can be shaped by others who hand us something of God in their very human lives, the communion of saints. And the way that other people so often carry our faith when we're weak, how the cloud of witnesses, past and present, they preserve this really long tradition of listening for God, even when we can't hear, or glimpsing grace when we can't see it, or reminding us always that we're not alone, even in the moments when we feel our most lonely. The web of life, the web of life, the interconnectedness of which we are always a part, even when we are numb and exhausted and done, carried by the web of life. There was this beautiful comment in the New York Times just a few weeks ago. A journalist, a world-weary journalist, who was at the funeral of his brother, who was in his 50s. And so he was grieving his brother, but he had his mother at his side. And so, of course, he was grieving for his mother, because is there anything more painful at any age than a mother losing a child? And this journalist said that as he was holding his mother's grief and his own grief in his heart for his brother, there was a moment that gave him the greatest hope, and it was this. It was when a member of his mother's congregation came up to her and said after in the receiving line, "We'll be there when the stillness comes." She didn't have to ask for help. Someone from her faith community knew that after the busyness of the funeral and the gathering of the people and the food that gets dropped off, there will be a stillness. And she didn't have to ask. Someone said to her, "We'll be there when the stillness comes." What grieving people need is to be compassionately accompanied, right? To feel that those who care about them are willing and able to tolerate the pain that they're feeling, to be there with them, to be present. I am called time and again to be with people. It's part of why I went into ministry. And you know what? There are very few words that you can say to brokenhearted people who've lost someone. And so what do? I try to respond to them with graciousness. And I do it by prayer. One of the first things Russ said to me when I went to my first dying person's bedside as a young, old student. I said to him, "What? Any words? What should I do?" And you know what he said? "On your way there, pray." That's it. And so I did. And now I still do. Whenever I go to be with someone who is suffering or broken, I just pray, "God, give me the graciousness to be with them and to give the encouragement they need for this day." And I'm not looking for words. It's a prayer to God. Which leads me to the second point that I wanted to make. I ask God for help. I ask God for help. If the first reason that we don't ask for help is because we value stoicism, the second reason, and I've heard this time and again, that we don't go to God for help and actually ask God for help is because we're not actually sure who or what it is that we're praying to. This is the most common reason that people give me that they stop praying, is because they're just not sure who or what it is that they're praying to, and then so what's the point? Or what are they going to do? Or what do I even ask if I don't know? I can't predict the outcome, so what's the point? And help is the first great prayer. Well, you don't have to know what you're praying to. You don't have to be able to define God. If there is a web of life, just picture it. There must be some force that created it, that contains it, that seemingly wants to perpetuate it and help it to live in myriad of ways. And so the weight of the world that you feel and the weight of the world that carries you, it must be held and carried by something greater than you and me and the sum of us. And we don't have to know exactly what it is. None of us possibly can, really. I like the word God. It's real to me. It is something that I can pray to. But I don't have to figure out how all this works. And figuring it out is not actually a good slogan for life. It's just enough to know that it is and that it does work. Let's be honest. Most of us, when we are faced with a crisis, especially a crisis that affects someone that we love, we're going to send up some prayers. Who of us has not been in a terrible situation and not sent up a few prayers, even if we don't know what we are praying to? It doesn't matter. A really hard truth is that everyone we love and for whom we pray with such passion will die. This is like a fly in the ointment of life. We can't change the unchangeable. And so we pray for them. Help this one that I love be okay. Help them come through. Help them let go. Help them die gracefully. Help the ones who are left behind. Help them bear this loss. Help them get through. Help. Help! This is the one great prayer. There are some prayers that are so beautifully pre-assembled. I write a lot of them. I don't know that I write beautiful prayers, but I write a lot of prayers. They're like the ones we say in worship. They're like the good china of prayers. And they have saved me on occasion. And I have spoken them at bedsides, and I've spoken them especially in these loving vigils that happen at a bedside of a dying person. But they are the prayers that truly are for the kind of special moments when I've got enough wits about me. You'll know that feeling, where you can remember to recite the 23rd Psalm. Not in the moments when you're just able to say help. Most good, honest prayers are really just about recognizing that you're not in charge. About opening ourselves to being helped by something, by some force, by some friends, by some something. Dear God, I don't know what I'm doing. I can't see where I'm going. I'm getting more lost. I'm getting more afraid. I'm getting more clenched. Help. It doesn't matter if you don't know who's receiving that prayer. It only matters to know that it makes a difference. I have seen what happens when people pray for help. I have seen prayers for help manifest as a kind of WD-40 into the most tightly clenched situations and people. I have been in these tight, scary rooms, and a prayer for help is, it's almost like a breath of fresh air blowing through. Something shifts. I have witnessed the intervention of angels, and I bet you have too. When people cry for help or pray for help, and it's manifest as people who appear in the right moment, in the right way, in the way that they're needed. Have you witnessed that ever? I have seen people survive unsurvivable losses. And I've seen them actually experience happiness again. How can that be? It just is. Because love flowed to them from their closest people and from their community. It surrounded them. It sat with them, it held them, it fed them, it swept their floors, and time passed, and in most cases, their pain evolved to where they could help someone else. The communion of saints, the web of life. Help. It might be necessary for you to leapfrog over this niggling, rational, intellectual mind that says, I get the web of life part. That part I can get, and I can concur. But the part that says I need to pray to God, or what holds that web of life and the intentions for it, that's a leap too far. And so fine, if it's a leap too far for you, I offer you this. Borrow my faith. Take my God. Or borrow the faith of the saints who came before us. Use their God. Or the person who's sitting next to you, use theirs. Oh God, our help in ages past. And I ask you this, just suspend your conviction for once. Just suspend it and just pray and ask for help, because we cannot carry the weight of the world and the weight of our hearts and the weight of one another in this room without help. So suspend your conviction and ask for help. Pretend that there is someone outside of you who hears you pray, and pray. Because you know what? When we run out of ideas on how to fix the unfixable, when we finally stop trying to heal our own sad, stressed out hearts with our own sad, stressed out hearts, when we finally do that, and when we're truly at the end of our rope and we just say, help, help will come because connections kick in. As long as we try to do it on our own, we don't let the connections kick in. The community at hand and the communion of saints and all those who cried help before you. The Old Testament writers who said, cast your burden on the Lord and he will sustain you. And God heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. And Isaiah, who heard the voice of God, and what God said was, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed. I am your God. Be not dismayed. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you. When we cry out for help, or when we whisper it into our chests, we release ourselves from the absolute craziness of trying to be our own higher power, or trying to be the higher power for someone else, for someone we're trying to fix, or situations that we're trying to fix that are beyond our control. When we ask for help, we get it. What's the old riddle? What's the difference between you and God? God doesn't think he's you. When we ask for help, we'll get it. Things will get a little better when we ask for help. Grace appears, blessings continue, people show up, nature restores. Saints, past and present, they urge us on. And the web of life is not broken by death or by grief. It holds it, us included, the weight of the world, held by the weight of the world. And God holds it all. God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. Thanks be to God. Amen. I wish I could come down here and walk among you. I don't like being so far away. Because we do open to the weight of the world, I want to add three flowers. So that while we listen to the mostly righteous as they sing, we remember the people from our community, and we also remember the people of the world who have died because of racism. The people of the world who have died because of conflict. caught in the middle of it, forced to fight it or flee from it. And the people of the world who've died because of climate crisis. These are the weights of the world. we turn now to prayer. The prayers this morning are going to be short. And these are for you. In the prayers of the people, I will invite you in a moment, as we pray to God, to actually say out loud into your mask the names of the people that you want to remember, and even the names of the people that you might want help to come, however God will help in its manifest ways. Don't be shy. There is something about saying the name out loud in the company and the communion of saints. And so these ones are for your people. And God will hear the names as you say them. Take a deep breath. Holy and gracious God, with open hearts and trust in the connection of all things, hear us as we say the names of those we wish to remember to you now. Jim. Hazel. Ed. Holy God, send your help where help is needed. And hear us as we pray together, saying, Our Mother, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn is one that, so many people have sung in this room. I'll make you wait for it. Shall we gather at the river? Let's stand and sing into our mouths.
Thank you.
Our opening hymn was written in 1997. That hymn was written in 1860 something or other. Listen, thank you for sharing, All Saints. And listen, ask for help. It's there, it will come. Pray it with your whole heart. And if you need the faith, use mine, use ours, and use the faith of the saints. But know this, God holds us all. God is our strength and our refuge, and we'll be fine. Go in peace. Amen.